welcome Mr. Suresh Bharwani, Chairman and Managing Director at Jet King. And welcome, sir. And let's welcome Mr. Agnello Rajesh, CMD at St. Angelo Professional Education. And finally, let's welcome Mr. Mohan Rajamani, co-founder, Learn High. Before inviting our moderator, may I quickly take you through her profile. Ladies and gentlemen, Ms. Bint Abbas, she is from National Skill Development Corporation. Prior to joining National Skill Development Corporation, Bint Abbas has been working in human resource in both consulting and internal HR roles. She has specialized in compensation and benefits in companies like Canon IDU and Hewitt Associates. She has also worked in world's largest youth-run organization, ISEC, and has led the Delhi office. In her current role in NSDC's program development team, she has done extensive work in Jammu and Kashmir region for Prime Minister's Special Industry Initiative, Udaan scheme. Till date, more than 40 corporates have partnered with the scheme and more than 29,000 candidates are engaged with the scheme. She also leads India's first skill development business plan competition, Power to Empower, that provides a platform for young entrepreneurs to share their business plan, get mentored by industry leader, and pitch their ideas for rewards and access to NSDC funding. Now, ladies and gentlemen, let's welcome Ms. Bint Abbas to give her opening remarks. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to this session, which is Entrepreneurship in Vocational Education. And I think it cannot be seen, but yeah. I think I'm very glad to be the moderator. I think the reason I've been chosen is to maintain the sex ratio on the podium, okay, to be representative of the females. The main objective and the key areas we really want to talk about in this session is to first question the fact, what is the requirement of getting into a business of vocational education? Is it really important? I mean, do we really need it? And to actually understand from young, from entrepreneurs who are actually on the ground, who have actually figured out a method in this madness, and they've actually figured out how to actually make a scalable, sustainable, you know, and a scalable, you know, business enterprise out of this skilling initiative. And what is India doing to ensure that there's a skill ecosystem, that actual entrepreneurs, large corporations, NGOs, they actually start looking at skill development as a good, viable business plan and actually start putting in their money and efforts into it. And also, I wanted to share some business models with you, you know, something which are tried and tested, how they're actually doing in India. And most importantly, I think that was a special recommendation made to us last evening, that what are the key takeaways for Kerala? If somebody wants to start doing skilling, get into business of skilling, what are the key takeaways? So I'm just going to take 2 minutes. I'm going to speak later after you know, everyone else speaks. But I'll just take two minutes to just talk about skilling. All right, am I visible now? Yeah, great. All right, so this is a very simple demographic that we want to see. We really want to tell you that as India, we are at the cusp of a demographic transition. What's happening is that we are going to be having 500 million people by the year 2022 who are going to be in the working age population. And they're going to be a lot of people who will be in the working age population and will be looking for jobs. And across industry by the year 2022, we're going to have a requirement of 347 million people across industries. Now, out of 347 million people, only 40 million people are going to be requirement of graduates, you know, who get those degrees and graduates. Rest, all of them are going to be requirements from employers who are going to be asking for skills. And that's why we have to start looking at this business opportunity of actually skilling the pending people and how we're going to do it across India. So the challenge that we have is that 347 million people are required, and out of 347 million, only 40 million people are going to be graduates. And candidates are required to be job worthy, employers are going to be paying more for them, and only out of 12.8 million youth entering the job market every year, only 2 to 8% of the workforce have any formal skills. So we have a problem here. We have employers who are recruiting people, but they have to spend so much time training and skilling them, and then not and spend that much money on them. And then we have students who are not employable. So this is really the challenge that we faced, and we thought that it's a very bold idea. We need a solid execution. And this started from even the finance minister saying that we better do this now. You know, it's not a matter of choice. It's a matter of something that we have to do, right? So a bold idea needs a solid execution. So simply, we came up with a national skills policy, which was aimed at by the year 2022. We need to skill 500 million people, and that's really the problem that we have, and also the opportunity that we have for young entrepreneurs. Now, there are two ways we're going to do it. We're going to do 350 million people by state governments and central ministries, and 150 million, we're going to get young entrepreneurs to start looking at private sector initiatives. We're going to have a large corporate start actually putting in their their effort into this. And we have to make this like a skill industry, like, you know, how industries boom. We have to make a skill industry where everybody starts making money out of this. So this is really the challenge. This is how we want to go ahead. And I'm going to talk about what NSDC is doing and how's the ecosystem getting created later when I talk to you. But this is a challenge, and now we're going to have people who actually put in their effort in this to talk about it. So I think first, can we have a huge round of applause for Mr. Suresh Bharwani, who leads Jet King, and he's going to talk about his experience.
Thank you, ma'am. Now, let me give you a brief profile of Mr. Suresh Bharwani. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Suresh Bharwani is the chairman and managing director at India's first and today's leading computer hardware and networking institute, Jet King Infotrain Limited. Ladies and gentlemen, established in the year 1983, Jet King Infotrain Limited, impressive growth is undoubtedly the results of Mr. Suresh's visionary philosophy. Today, it is a rupees 125 crore company with its 110 training centers mapping the length and breadth of the Indian subcontinent. Today, at 58, Suresh clearly remembers how he added the force of his young stride to the venture in the year 1974 and took the business towards what can today be considered a foundation of the Hardware and Networking Training Institute. Now, let's welcome Mr. Suresh Bharwani to give his presentation. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I'm really delighted to use whom I have been interacting with him. I don't see him here. I saw this mind-boggling numbers with Bint Abbas. She was, while coming from airport, I was with her. And really, NSDC has been doing a yeoman's job. It has made a vision. The vision comes from something very scary. You have heard about something like revolution happening in Egypt, Tunisia, Syria, in place like Japan. This is a McKinsey report, which says 2 lakh people, 2 lakh students are sitting home and coordinating with each other and talking about unemployment. There is unemployment show in America. So it was very nice of Government of India to make a plan. When I started, I started out of majboori. I will go back to my history. It is quite interesting. So I would like to share this vocational training. It was 1947. My father, who was a revolutionary himself in Pakistan, he had made a bomb. And bomb exploded prematurely, and he was bundled into ship and came to Bombay. Now he didn't have anything to do. There was no purpose, no vision. So he worked with his uncle for 3 years, who was 3 months, and he was already in Bombay, he knew something about Bombay. His mother had bought 50,000 worth gold, which got exhausted in next 6 months. So he started something called Nava Bharat Radio Agency. World War II had ended in 1945. And in 47, there were a lot of war surpluses. He was stationed in Bombay, and he would import valves and wall radios. At that time, you might have heard, there were no radios or no small pocket transistors. Now you have got a multi-purpose mobile where you can do everything. But at that time, there were big gramophones that will work on 90-volt batteries. And people love to listen to BBC London and news from Germany and various places. So he used to travel to Bombay. At that time, there was a Madras and Calcutta. And he would sell those war plus surpluses. And he was, at that time also, he had a motto of banishing unemployment. Though there is a very big vision, but he had banished unemployment. He will import those components and make a circuit board or a small 3-4 page instruction manual and sell to youngsters who will maybe make 30-40 rupees on each radio and sell in the market. So that vision comes from my father that he established in 47. In 62, he established a small radio factory and do-it-yourself kits for table radios. And at that time, Sony had introduced germanium transistors. In 1974, I am a BCom graduate. I came from a very nice college called Sydenham College, one of the elite colleges in Bombay. And he had, at that time, there was a license Raj. Today, people fund you for your ideas. At that time, getting even license from government of Maharashtra was a tough task. So he had kept that my son will come. So I was lucky to have a license. I started a small factory. And that time I designed two-band transistors. India has got two religions. One is Bollywood and second is cricket. At time, Radio Ceylon used to broadcast Binaka Geet Mala and local AM stations. Some of you can relate to all this. They used to broadcast cricket match. So one of the most important thing entrepreneur has to do is to innovate relentlessly. So I designed one pocket transistor which had two bands or maybe one and a half band. That radio, you can listen to Radio Ceylon and you can listen to AM, local. Today you listen to FM. So that was one thing that helped me a lot. I sold around 10 lakh radios in 10 years, make good money, bought offices all over. And I became very ambitious. For 10 years I sold radios that I want to manufacture TVs. Though as an entrepreneur, I couldn't calculate. Some of you can calculate in your mind and tell me if somebody who's first, how much is 8,000 multiplied by 1,000? How much it comes to your mind? Quickly. 8 crore. What he says, 80, anybody? 8 million. So it is 80 lakhs. I didn't do much calculation. And I ask many audience, but lot of entrepreneurs, it is, even at some of, I was delivering lecture to IIT Powai. Young engineers couldn't make a small calculation. Of course, you make all the calculation in Excel. Only thing was required was passion. I started a factory in backward area of Lonawala, because government was giving licenses at that time. And from 86, I shifted to that small village and started TV factory. Within 6 years, I lost 3 crores, which is equivalent to 60 crores of this time. And I had a loan from State Bank of India, 1 crore from Canara Bank, 1 crore, and 1 crore from my friends. I had to sell all my 3 properties, Delhi office, Bangalore office, Bombay office, and my 6 cars, and all the drivers were gone. And I started a journey. What I can do? I went to my friends, relatives, banks, to no, we can't help you. And what I can do best? I used to train my sales people. So I said, I can do best is to train people in communication skills. I thought I'm great. As a Jet King, I have manufacturers, radio, tape recorders, TVs. I should start teaching radio, tape recorders, and TVs. And at that time, this NIT software training was rage. They were in 10 years of happening, and 1,000, I think I must say, Mr. Tarun Mitra, who's sitting from the APTEC, they have done a great job. Every year, they used to teach around 2 lakh people in software programming. So I wanted to follow the herd. That I said, I will teach radio, tape recorder, TV, software. And by chance, somebody told me, I know something about microprocessor. At that time, there was 8086. Some of you engineer can identify that I will teach hardware. And first month when I started a course at 12,000 rupees. And 3 months I was sitting for the students. I got only 7 students. I started on 27 March 1990. So somebody, I said, now how can I pay my salaries? How can I pay my debts? I was standing in front of Justice Variava, who was a Supreme Court judge, that either pay your debts or we will sell your house and everything. So that dagger was on my head. So I said, what should I do? I reduced the prices of my courses by half. And there were 162 people joined my radio tape recorder. But going it further was very difficult. I said, what to do? Only thing that will work is innovation. I met one consultant who told me, Suresh, you have to focus. You can't teach radio, tape recorder, TV. You don't know what is your capacity. You don't have that much space or management bandwidth that you can teach all. And we stopped teaching software, radio, tape recorder. And at that time, Rajiv Gandhiji had introduced computers to India. And I started teaching computers. I went for franchising. From say 92 till 2008, we appointed 140 franchises. Till now, I have trained more than 6 lakh students. In 2000, everybody else was having problems, but still, because there was nobody to teach hardware and networking, I got a good response and my company's growth curve went up. Now, today what NSDC is doing a great job. In India, there is a dearth of skills and we are going to, if you see the government of UP is giving away, I think lakhs of computer to young people. Some people say they gave a computer worth 20,000 rupees, they go and sell it for 6,000 rupees. But some of them are starting a small shops or training or whatever they can do as a small entrepreneur and doing a good job. So vocational training, one of the innovation we did was give a 100% job guarantee. It is a toughest task we do. Every time, one thing you should do every time when you think as an entrepreneur, that what is one thing you are going to do that is going to make a tremendous impact on your future. One thing that will do have a tremendous impact, and focus on one or two things in your life. So these are the few, some of the ideas which I have for entrepreneurs. There is a great scope. Many speakers will tell you that it is entrepreneurship is taking risk. Risk is inherent in entrepreneurship. Otherwise, you should do a job. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Suresh Bharwani. And now, ladies and gentlemen, our next speaker, Mr. Agnello Rajesh, is the CMD at St. Angelo Professional Education, an institution for technology and management education. Other than education, is also into construction, hospitality, and hotel business. He has business interests in Maharashtra, Tamil Nadu, Goa, UK, Australia, and New Zealand. He's a director of Mini Business Forums and a member of DAI. And now let's welcome Mr. Agnello Rajesh for his presentation.
I'm sure it's been a long day for you. It's a great feeling being in God's own country. Kerala is always beautiful. I've loved this place. It's green and fantastically developed. This has been a trip after a couple of years, and I've seen the development happen. Friends, I'm supposed to be speaking on vocational education and the business opportunities in vocational education. I think there is a huge amount of opportunities in this space, and the objective of this session is going to be how I can motivate people who can get into the vocational education domain. It's huge. Population, which was once upon a time supposed to be a curse on India, has become our complete strength. The whole world today is looking at India as a land of opportunities. India is a world in a country. With more than 1 billion people, India is definitely a world in a country with multiple opportunities. And every single country in the world is dependent on India in some format or the other. When I'm speaking this, I'm a very, very proud Indian, as every one of you in this hall. When I'm speaking this, I mean serious business, because every country has got something to do with India. The world sees us as opportunities. I always tell my friends that because of the population that we have, the rest of the world will develop India as a business domain for them, as a land of business for them. The company which wants to sell the car will make the road in India. The job of the government will only be to maintain law and order, and the business opportunities will be multiplied by the rest of the world. We get very disappointed when the dollar prices shoot up. That is a sad part of the story. It restricts our shopping, our purchasing, our traveling abroad, our investments abroad. But if you see the better side of it, it is inviting the whole world to invest into India, because they are getting a better value for their currency. They are getting a better value for their investments. When I'm saying that India is a very great opportunity to invest, we have two countries in one country. One is India, which is the urban cities of this country, and one is Bharat, the villages of this country. We have got more than 628,000 villages, which is a huge business opportunity for each one of us sitting in over here, because these villages need to be developed like the cities, like the urban places, and for that, investments and entrepreneurs will be required. I've always understood that for any country to lead economically, it has to have a large number of entrepreneurs. Large number of employees won't do. We might become a good customer country. We can become good consumers. But for the country to lead globally, the country needs to have large number of entrepreneurs. I also know that the quality of an individual, the quality of a family, society, state, or a country depends on the quality of people they have. And this quality is ensured by the quality of education that they get. We all know education also comes in two format. One is the academic format, which is classroom and theoretical based training. And the other topic that we are going to discuss is the vocational training, that is a skill set based training. Today, with a population of more than 1 billion, I'm sure NSDC will give better figures on this. We are having a 45 crore population, which is the earning population, which is the population which works. It might be anything. It might be pulling a cart. It might be flying a plane. But 45 crore people are there in India, which is the earning population. Out of this 45 crore population, we are adding 1.2 crore working population every year. We are tipped to be having 50 crore population by 2022, which will be earning for their families and for the country. Out of this 45 crore population that is there today, hardly 7 to 8% of the population are skill based. They are having some form of skill because of which they are able to earn. And out of this 45 crore population, there is only 5% population which is formally educated and are having marketable skills. Which means there is a huge gap. A lot of people are trying to earn wages for their families, but they are not skillful. They are not skillfully trained. Which means vocational education has a brilliant opportunity. Friends, you will be shocked and surprised to know that the school registrations in India are to the tune of around 22 crores. 22 crores. And the next number will shock you. The people who join or complete education after the higher education and vocational education is only 1.5 crores. There is a huge gap. India is one of the countries which has got the highest dropout ratio after 12th in the world in proportion to the population that it has. The highest dropout ratio. But that does not mean the end to the world, because education, if not taken academically, can also be taken as a vocation. That's the reason organizations like the National Skill Development Corporation, which is a combination, it's a Section 25 company, if I'm not wrong, it's a Section 25 company started by the Finance Ministry under the Labor and Employment Ministry also in collaboration with them, where there is a PPP, a public-private partnership, which will create the infrastructure to give vocational education to the masses of this country. It has got two objectives. One objective would be to provide educational platform to the audience of this country, to the population of this country. And the second objective is to empower entrepreneurs to take vocational education as a business opportunity and create infrastructure where the students can be trained. So the students are going to be getting support in terms of finance, in terms of paying fees from the government. And the entrepreneurs are going to get business opportunity because this captive audience can be educated by them in where the government will pay this vocational education entrepreneurs and they can make a huge business model. Friends, India as a country has a lot of challenges, but these challenges are opportunities in disguise. In most of the part of the country, probably in more than 70% part of the country, we don't have electricity 24 hours, we don't have proper water supply, we don't have proper roads connected to this country. But these are the opportunities of this country, and all these opportunities are going to be encashed by people who are skillfully trained to encash these opportunities. This is again going to be divided into two categories. One category is the labor force, which will be required to build the health infrastructure, the education infrastructure, the real estate infrastructure, the textile industries, the pharma industries, you name the industries, the automobile industries, all these industries will be needing a lot of skilled manpower. And when this is being done, money will flow into the economy. Economics has a very powerful statement which says expenditure in the economy leads to income to the people. And when these opportunities are going to be at our doorsteps, we need to be ready to encash these particular opportunities. Today we are paying 62 rupees for buying one American dollar. I'm sure economically we will be strong very soon by 2060. 2060 we are supposed to be a superpower economically. At that time, probably we'll be able to buy $62 for one Indian rupee. For all that matters, it all depends on how entrepreneurship is going to develop in this country. It all depends on that. Education of the masses of India is going to be a task which the Indian government is taking on very seriously. Friends, Roti Kapda or Makan, if made now, will be a flop movie. It has to be Roti Kapda Makan or education. The education component is very, very important for India as a country to progress. And government cannot do much in this because it moves with a very slow pace. The requirements of the industry, the requirements of employers is so quickly changing that these dynamics can be matched only by private entrepreneurs who can be backed by the government in the form of national skill development corporations. Every country, every state in this country has been given targets to improve the skill sets of their people. And every state is working very aggressively in close coordination with their labor and employment governments. Every industry in India has a vocational education skilled student to be absorbed, whether it is automobiles, whether it is textiles, whether it is education, whether it is IT and ITES, whether it is insurance, whether it is banking, you name the industry, and everybody has got a great scope to absorb people who can grow those particular industries. What I foresee is that a lot of villages are going to be getting into this wave of educating their people. You'll be surprised to know, friends, 41% of the working population is engaged in agricultural activity. 41% is engaged in the agricultural activity, but the contribution of the agricultural sector to the economy of India is only 20%. 25% of the contribution to this economy comes from the manufacturing sector, and 55% comes from the services sector, which means there is a fantastic scope in the manufacturing and the services sector also. Our agricultural sector is growing only at 4%. Our manufacturing sector is growing at 8%. Our services sector is growing at 9%. For India to maintain a GDP growth of 8 to 9%, the manufacturing and the services industry needs to grow at 11 to 12%, making sure that the agriculture still grows at 4%. Friends, which means a lot of migration is happening from villages to the metros, to the cities, because they want to get into the factories and they want to get into the services sector. This also means agricultural sector also has a lot of demand because it is income tax money, it is tax-free money. Agricultural sector also needs to have a lot of technological development, which can again happen through a lot of vocational training. And this is what is going to be unfolding in the coming years. Our skilled workforce ratio of only 5% of the 45 crore is lowest in the world, where developed countries have 60% of their population fully skilled and well educated to perform any services in the field of agriculture or manufacturing or services. They are totally automized. They are having technology used to the core, to the T, and that is what footsteps that we are as a country going to follow in the near future. So friends, I see a great opportunity for every entrepreneur getting into the space of vocational education, and that's going to be a very, very big future in the future. Healthcare, education, infrastructure, finance, banking, these are the green sectors of this country, and I'm sure some of you will be penetrating into this in some form or the other. And the best form to get into is the vocation space, where you can set up infrastructures which can supply skilled and qualified manpower to the respective industries. Thanks a lot, friends. Have a nice evening.
Thank you very much, Mr. Agnalu Rajesh, CMD at St. Angelo Professional Education, for that excellent presentation. And now let's welcome our next speaker, Mr. Mohan Rajamani, co-founder LearnHive. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Mohan Rajamani is the co-founder of LearnHive. Previously, he was the director of Cash Technologies in India, which he founded over 17 years back, and is regarded as one of the pioneers who built PC XT systems in India. Mohan has been on the advisory board of several organizations to transform the use of technology in various verticals. He was an advisor to Indus International School and assisted with their technology program. He's currently on the advisory board of Primus School in Bangalore. Now let's welcome Mr. Mohan Rajamani for his presentation. Thank you.
Good evening, everybody. So being the last speaker this evening, I think I'm going to have a little bit of a challenging task to keep you all engaged, and perhaps hopefully I'll be able to get to the right point. And the floor has already been set, and I was kind of inspired by Mr. Suresh Parwani's story. And hence, I'll also share a very quick story about LearnHive and about myself. So in this picture, this was one of the schools which many, many cities and towns in India are having, with about 90 or 100 kids. And I was probably the last bencher you can never see me raise a hand. So that was me once upon a time, right? So it was called one of the conventional typical Tam Bram families where I was born and raised into. And we were considering, or we were all thinking, that doing business was a crime and making money was a sin. So that was the kind of typical Tam Bram Iyer families that we were all hailing from. And with that in the background, and I couldn't complete my engineering, so I was really struggling with all my core concepts. So I realized that the problem, over time, that I realized what the problem was rote learning, poor teacher-student ratio, and poor understanding of core concepts, inconsistent quality of teachers across geographies. Vast majority of the parents think they have outsourced the problem of education to schools, and lack of individual attention, and lack of inclusion of key subjects like leadership, creativity, innovation, businesses, etc. So this was the core problem that we were all staring at when I was thinking of this venture called LearnHive. And we really wanted to transform the Indian education system, and when we take vocational, I wanted to address the bottom end of the pyramid, that is this core schooling alone. So and some more numbers to throw at you, that transforming Indian education, a child is born every 2 seconds in India alone. So imagine the world population, and which translates to about 30 children a minute. And in 2010, there was about 27 million children born, and this is the source from the Hindu. And out of this, only 53.2% of children in class 5 could barely read class 2 textbooks, right? So these are all the reports that are published. And what it translated to were how many graduates do we produce? And the question we actually need to ask ourselves is not how many graduates that we produce, but how many they are employable, right? So India produces about 50 lakh graduates every year, of which only 50% are employable. So this is the big problem that we are all staring at. And there are some more data facts. And this is the Baro-Lee data set that is that Baro-Lee figured out, that out of this whole table, there is no schooling for 33 out of 100 children. And about 41 children go to primary school and secondary school by about 21, and 5 people have gone to some college. And that's what Mr. Agnello Rajesh clearly pointed out a while ago, right? So we wanted to move India from a labor arbitrage IT powerhouse to an intellectual property leader. So that's where our vision that we set as an organization. And India has seen a 100 billion IT industry in the last 15 years. So the long-term growth for India will be in developing own IP across technology, media, and education. And we focused core on the education. So you look at all the large labor arbitrage IT industries like Wipro, Infosys, TCS, and the very many. So we decided that we are going to be in the product space. And that is when the birth of LearnHive came. And we put our BHAG, as what we say, the big, hairy, audacious goal, is to be the number one trusted e-learning platform from cradle to grave. And to that vision that we set, and we said we will be the, currently we are the only company in the world that offers for the K-12 segment comprehensive curriculum-based content and educational games on multiple consumption devices, on any device that you can think of, Kindle Fire, Android or iOS, and so on and so forth. And we wanted to help guarantee to the children that by spending just 20 minutes in a day, they will be able to do better in schools and understand core concepts better. So with that, we also introduced something called as the learning cards. So these were the innovations that we bought out for the school education per se. So if you take this, these are basically paper-based cards. They're being retailed in Sapna Bookhouse and Oxford bookstores. So what these cards are essentially are a summary of the textbook. So we compress the whole number system, which is taught in about 9 pages, into just one page, one card, which says number system is nothing but natural numbers, n is equal to 1 up till infinity and 0. These two put together becomes whole numbers and negative numbers put together becomes integers. So the child is able to understand the correlation of the entire number system. So the child has understood this concept well. He comes online and takes our assessment with this code that is there on the top left-hand corner. So this is, again, we put everything we did was to put all the concepts together on all the key concepts. So for example, a child in ninth grade is expected to know surface area and volume. So in order to do surface area and volume of a cone, for example, the child must know in their formative years the number system taught in grade 1, addition taught in grade 2, subtraction, multiplication, division. And we all know division is nothing but repetitive subtraction and multiplication nothing but repetitive addition. So this is where the core of their schooling is really, really made well understood instead of the rote learning. All the concepts are taught well, and they've all been meta-tagged on our platform. So that is what we did. We did all the, from kindergarten to 10th grade, we put each one of the topics together. We meta-tagged it to every concept. So supposing a child in 9th grade is supposed to take surface area and volume, he should know all the core concepts. So this is what we've done for every single topic. That is a huge repository of close to 5.5 lakh question bank on our platform. Right? So we also understood that these are the three verticals that largely there are problems associated in terms of students, that learning help is scattered, unreliable, and difficult to find. And for the schools, teachers are unable to quickly find student learning gaps. And for the education businesses, unable to offer quality educational content in a single platform. Right? So this is the solution approach that we had from assessment and helping them to acquire better knowledge and achieve better in their school, that is in the formative years. Right, so this is our value proposition for everybody, that is the student, schools, and educational businesses. And our business has been in the freemium consumer business model with products and services. So in the last 18 months, this is what we have been able to achieve. We have launched about 21 apps, 25 books, 2,000 titles, 700K questions, and published. And we have about 14 schools that we have launched our platform into. And these are some of the stats that we have. This is our portfolio of products, the learning cards that I explained to you a little while ago. We cater to all the different syllabi, ICSE, IB, IGCSE, Common Core Standards, and Finnish Boards. So this is our leadership team. We are 5 co-founders. I'm a serial entrepreneur. This is my 3rd venture. And a gentleman, Captain Unnikrishnan, he was the founder of Indus International School and Primus Public School. Shiv Shankar, he was the head of Intel India. And 2 gentlemen from Goldman Sachs, Arindam Nag and Tajinder Singh Sidhu. So together we formed the 5 of us, and that's the summary of my presentation. Thank you very much, gentlemen.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mohan Rajamani. Now, ladies and gentlemen, our moderator, Ms. Bint Abbas, I'd also like to give you a presentation. May I invite her for a presentation, followed by rounding up of the session. Thank you.
Thank you, everybody. I think it's great to actually hear entrepreneurs talk about pure passion, how they actually figured out that some people figure out from a picture that, you know, how important it is to actually get education, which actually leads to some kind of learning and actually gives you employability, and other from pure passion. So I want to take a minute or so to tell you what is NSDC doing to actually ensure that people start looking at skill development as a viable, scalable business. NSDC has a unique model. It was made to create, fund, and enable. Create to actually help quality training institutions actually come up. And at the same time, do not just leave them just to tell them to create them. We want to make their risk reduced. So we wanted to actually have a stake in their entire business. So we wanted to make sure that they reduce their risk, and we take some of their risk till the business actually flourish. And also just not tell them that, you know, just make a business, we'll take your risk, but do not give an ecosystem. So we also wanted to ensure that businesses in the skill development also are enabled to actually flourish. So these are really the three key things that we work on a continuous basis to ensure that skill development is happening in India. So what are the multiple things that we're doing? We have now 27 sector skill councils. Now these are industry-led bodies by, for example, if there's automobile, all the industry people in the automobile will come together and they will decide the norms and the occupational structure that's required for every single role, all right? And this is going to be certified by the industry. That means if trainers get certified with those industry-led bodies, then the employers are willing to pay more for the candidate that's been trained. Right, so that's one of the things that we've done to ensure that these sector skill councils come in place so that employers are willing to pay more for skilled labor. The second thing we wanted to make sure that if entrepreneurs wanted to do business, let's say in Uttar Pradesh or in Kerala, like how would you know what are the people aspiring to do? Like are people looking at a career at plumbing? And even if they are, is there even an industry in Kerala in plumbing, right? So we did a district skill gap study to understand what are the different skills required, what kind of investment is going to happen till the year 2022 to understand that, where should skill development, which areas should businesses flourish in a state. So we have 25 completed studies. We have also studies in 20 high growth sectors to actually people to start looking for it. And the other thing was that a lot of times people are willing to spend money on an MBA, right, which does not give you, let's say, a job. But the fact that I have an MBA degree makes me feel like I can get a job, right? So how you actually make kids feel that, yes, I want to do skilling, and you know, how do I actually spend that 10,000 rupees for getting a plumbing skilling training? So what we did was we've partnered with some of the NBFC, some of the banks, that okay, fine, we're going to help you out. There's another very interesting scheme that has been launched, which I think is going to change the game of skills. It's called the STAR scheme, in which what we're saying is, if a candidate actually goes for a training which is actually certified by the sector skill councils, if they complete the training, then this candidate gets 10,000 rupees as incentive. Right, so that really encourages lots of people around different districts to start taking skilling as an educational something that they want to do. The other thing we wanted to do was, if I have an MBA, I cannot become a plumber. If I become a plumber, I mean, you know, it's a confusing which part do I actually go ahead. So we're trying to come up with a national qualification framework in which we're trying to merge these two. So for example, a class 10 person finishes class 10, both can actually go ahead and actually do plumbing course or a electrician course or whatever course, the IT course and things like that. So these are the things that we're doing. The other thing we're doing, something that we're very, very passionate about, is the fact that we have Olympics of skills. You know, it was held in Germany this year, and we actually got 3 medallions in IT, in networking, and in software. And these were people, and in jewelry. And these were people. There was a kid who's a class five dropout. There was one person who got the IT award, who was actually class 12 dropout. But these are people who actually went and represented India in skills and actually got awards. So we actually want to start making this something that people want to look up to. The other thing that we're doing is a media campaign. You know, we want to actually force people to start thinking that, great, you want, I mean, if Sachin Tendulkar made 100 in a test cricket, that's awesome. But do you know who made his bat? It takes a lot of skill to actually make his bat, and you sort of have to start thinking about that. So we're doing a campaign called Hunar Hai Toh Qadar Hai, and we're hoping that, you know, the stigma of like plumbing and electrician actually becomes an aspirational thing for people to start enrolling into it. At the same time, we have a business plan competition where we're getting, this year we've got about 500 business plans all across India. We're going to be evaluating them, giving them mentorship, actually building their plans to a point they actually get NSDC funding. Last year we had a partner called Just Rozgar who participated in the competition, and now Just Rozgar is getting funding from NSDC. And we also, because this is a new, it's a new thing for us. We don't know. We're also figuring it out. So we're trying to get a lot of help from international organizations to actually work this out for us. So this is multiple initiatives that we're taking to ensure that, you know, that people start looking at skill as a good thing. Now, very importantly, who gets funded? Anybody can get funded. It has to be a scalable model. It has to be a sustainable model. It has to ensure that skill is being given. Now, for us, skill is very, maybe English communication could be skills, or what can be skills? For skills, if after the training that's been delivered, a candidate gets a better salary, a better job, or starts his own business, that's skills, right? What is the form of funding? It's 75% of the project cost has been given by NSDC. Okay, and 25% has to be given by the promoters or the entrepreneur. And we have a moratorium of 3 years or 4 years, and a 6% loan. We also take equity in companies and also give grants. The grants could be for example, if there's a simulation that's been created and really requires, investment, we also give grants. And is there a focus on some kind of industry, not the other? No, we're willing to actually go ahead and fund any kind of this thing as long as the skill quotient is actually answered. So we have 103 partners, 16 million annually. We're going to create capacity. Very interestingly, both male and female are getting enrolled in skilling programs, freshers and experienced, and even from the age of 20 to 40, a lot of people are getting enrolled in it. They are just analysis of what is happening in India right now and how what kind of people are actually getting into and actually looking at skills and trying to get that training. So we have partners, we have education business, we have unrelated business, we have startups, we have different kind of people who are actually getting into it. We have 26 sector skill councils, as I already told you. We have district skill gap studies. We have high priority sector studies, so you can actually look into it as to how you want to do it. This is one of the campaigns, Hunar Hai Toh Azadi Hai. We're trying to launch this. These are the winners of the World Skills competition. This is the STAR scheme launched. And if anybody wants to know details of the STAR scheme, I think it's a very good incentive for trainers, training organizations to actually get enrolled in the STAR scheme and actually make this a good proposition for training partners and the candidate itself. So I'm going to talk about Kerala. Kerala in a bit. I think we could take question and answers first and then talk about Kerala. Or you want to? Okay. So these are the various things that we are doing to ensure that skill actually is something that people look at it. Now we've done a district skill gap study on Kerala. We went ahead to all the districts of Kerala and actually analyzed what are the youth aspiration. And the entire study is actually on our website called NSD on nsdcindia.org. So it's very, very detailed. You should definitely go ahead if you're looking at doing starting a business in skills. Now this is a simple grid that we actually have come up with after a lot of analysis, a lot of FGDs, and a lot of things. We've mapped two things. Number one is what is the incremental manpower demand that is required in Kerala, and what is the youth aspiration? There's no point of actually starting a business where there's no investment happening, and people are not going to be willing to pay for that training, right? So actually, if you look at communication, BFSI, retail, real estate, ITA, ITES, healthcare, engineering, MSME, education, and skill development, these are going to be areas where there's going to be high incremental manpower demand, and also students are going to be willing to pay for those kind of trainings, right? So this is where you actually want to start your businesses in, right? And you want to get your training certified by the sector skill councils so that after the training gets done, the child gets a certificate, actually goes to an employer, and the employer is willing to pay more, right? Even within the district or even within the state or outside. This is actually a little bit in-depth, but I just want to give you a snapshot. We also have studies that if you want to start business in BFSI, which districts do you have to go to, what kind of training you have to give. Right, so these are things which are available on our website. So you should definitely go ahead and look into it. Now, I just want to spend some time on the fact that there is no one method, one way of doing skill development businesses. Right, there are multiple ways of doing it, and a lot of people learn by just doing it. And the key is we as NSDC also are learning by doing it. Right, the key is that it all is based on innovation. You can try different methods. You can actually do traditional training in which you actually have a hub and spoke method, or you actually have mobile centers. For example, we have a partner, Krikradai, which actually goes from one construction site to another construction site and have trainers in them. And between their hard days at work, they give 1 hour and they tell them how to mix cement properly and things like that. So they figure out a way that the people are not going to come to their centers and learn construction, but they figure out they've got a mobile system that actually goes to various construction sites, and people are getting more and more salary. They are getting better job roles in the place that they already are. So now more and more people are getting involved in it. The other thing is that one of the most important thing is that fine, you want to do training in plumbing, but who's going to give you training in plumbing, right? You'd have to train the trainers. So I think that's also a really big area that we're looking at, that we want to invest in organization which are actually going to train those skills to trainers to actually go ahead and teach this to the students. And one, I think this is very, very, I mean, I really enjoy it because this is one of the key things of skill development. You can actually choose, let's say, a value chain of skill development. For example, if placement is a problem, right? For example, if placement, like for example, I train somebody, but there's nobody to actually take that student as trainer. So there's a very interesting model called babajobs.com. They've made a Naukri for informal sector. So if you're looking for a plumber, electrician, or you're looking for any other, they have it there, and people can go there, ask for a plumber, ask for electrician. Or they have things like, you know, their organization like Microspin, which has actually made cotton weaving, and you know, there was a place where cotton weaving used to happen, and they made a small simulation which taught how to do it really, really quickly, and now they've made a good business out of it. So you actually can get into any small part of the skill development. It could be content, it could be placement, it could be certification, it could be financing, it could be IT. I think IT is the most important thing that we're actually looking at. That, you know, we want people to start getting experiential learning through IT platforms, right? So those are also key things that you can actually take up and start your businesses. And this is my personal interest, and I'm hoping that by the year 2022 or even before, we get a Matrimonial ad which says that a plumber looking for a very good wife which has a BA degree honors and things like that. I'm hoping that India actually has that by 2022. Thank you so much.
50 million, and where are the huge gaps or white spaces existing?
Yeah. So we have 150 million, which is actually that we are going to be that we have to skill, right? But there was also a slide which says 347 million people are required by industries across industries, right? So it's actually to see that, for example, automobiles, IT, ITES, unorganized sector. These are very high priority sectors which are going to be looking for people, right? So there are also skill gap studies of every single sector. You can actually look at where you want to invest.
It's available in your website.
That's available on
our website. In the Kerala site slide, you mentioned that BFSI is there's a high requirement as well as aspiration. But do you know where this, which are the specific roles?
Yeah.
So as a person living in Kerala, if you look at BFSI industry, there's a bloodbath. A lot of people are moving there, entry level sales, operations jobs are going. So when you say that BFSI, there's a huge gap.
So this is also actually going to the year 2022, right? So it's also analysis of what's going to happen in COVID, right? It's still the 12th year plan. So if you want what kind of skills, what kind of
which district you want to go and go ahead and do it, it's all available on our website. And I mean, there's also a team member of mine who actually is dealing with this skill gap studying. Would be very happy to connect with her and take this forward if you want.
So where does
this
private players, if I started
training,
where do they come? How will they be
budgeted? So they've got management, but we as NSDC and also the private players have to do in a sustainable, in a profitable sort of manner, right? The only thing that, I don't know how would they work, but the only thing is the fact that we have sector skill councils, the fact that certification will be given, the fact that there's going to be there's a star scheme that's been launched, if a training has been given on a specific skill which is approved by the sector skill council, then a candidate will get 10,000 rupees minimum. These are going to be some incentives, for candidates to actually enroll, and also for employers to pay more for the candidates. So it's also a choice that a candidate has to make, but this is what the private initiatives are going to do. Also, if you have anybody has any questions for the panelists, would be happy.
Can I add some more to your question? We are private players. Like, I'm also into the IT space in Bombay. We are into IT education. NSDC has got two formats, I suppose. One format is to rope in existing players with network, systems, experience, and exposure. And second format is to encourage even new entrepreneurs who want to come with a business plan, and they will do the seed funding. They will do the viability gap funding, and they will launch them. Because to train so many people in terms of crores, you will need thousands of institutions. And a private player will always have the passion to make sure that quality of education reaches to the student. The government will ensure, since it is backing a private player, the government is sure that he will ensure that quality is given, otherwise others won't join him, the private player. So I think it's a fantastic public-private partnership which will definitely give the desired results. So this is an opportunity. Existing players with networks are also welcome, and probably new players will also join this. A lot of corporate companies, a lot of manufacturing industries are also creating training facilities because they have orders in hands, but they don't have, they have orders in hands, they have machines in place, but they don't have the right skilled manpower to execute those orders. So a lot of corporates, a lot of manufacturing organizations are investing in training capabilities and trying to create a workforce which will ultimately lead to their own better productivity percentages. So I think this is a very good phenomena that's unfolding in India, and in this scenario a lot of people should come on board as entrepreneurs.
My questions is for the panel. How does NST ensures the quality and the standardization of the content provided by the private players, particularly entrepreneurs, in the vocational training?
All right, so we have 26 sector skill councils, right? These are industry-led bodies who have, you know, for example, retail, we'll have all the largest retail players and also the smaller retail players who'll come and have a discussion on what are going to be the national occupation standards, which means that they're going to be like 10 different roles in that industry. What is the competency that's been required? What kind of training content needs to be there? And then a training partner can actually go, give their training material to the sector skill councils. They vet the training material and they give a certification. That means your training now is certified by the National Occupational Standard, right? Which is recognized by the industry, right? So now your training would be certified, and the child will also get certification and also will be recognized by the employers.
And thank you, ma'am. One more question. Since from the Kerala point of view, as you know that majority of the job opportunities are overseas, so how does NST ensures for the private players in tapping job opportunities in overseas, particularly in vocational training?
So to be honest, I mean, we haven't really got any proposal which says that we're going to train in India and send them abroad, because that's really not the idea. We've done a migration study, and the details of that is in the Kerala study, which basically says that the willingness to actually migrate is very high of youth of Kerala. So I think we'll have to, and also investment is also happening a lot, right? So we'll have to find a balance between the two and actually figure out what kind of training do we actually give in Kerala that people actually get skilled here and also want to stay in Kerala. I think that's a research and a choice that the training partner will definitely have to make.
Sorry, excuse me.
I think Kerala has got some fantastic opportunities, because Kerala is tipped to be achieving 1 crore 35 lakhs vocationally trained manpower by 2022, which means every year 15 lakh people from the state need to be trained on vocational education. It's a huge opportunity. Compared to that, there are hardly 430 private vocational players and only 160 outlets of the Kerala Industrial Training Department, which means there is a lot of scope, because this quantum, 600, 700 people with institutions can't train 15 lakh people per annum. So that itself will be giving a huge gap. This 670, 700 or 800 institutions which are present in Kerala will suffice hardly 1.5-2 lakh people. So there is a gap for training the balance 13 lakh people which need to be trained. As per the population census of Kerala, as per the projections that need to be done over the next few years till 2022. So I think that's a brilliant opportunity for vocational education in Kerala per se. And Kerala government has also set up the Kerala Academy for Skills and Excellence. This is another department which Kerala Academy for Skills Excellence has been set up, which I think again private players will be collaborating with and creating business opportunity in the vocational education domain.
What are the sources of the data, the 15 lakhs?
This is all authentic data given by the Kerala government.
15 lakh
per annum. And by 2022, Kerala will need to train 1 crore 35 lakh Keralites.
This is a portion of that 50 crore people to be trained by 2022. So this is a part of the Kerala state. All. This is, see, when you're talking about a vocational education program, the student who is being trained on a particular vocation need not necessarily work in Kerala. He will work in Kerala, in India or abroad. It is immaterial. The objective is to develop and build skills of the population so that they can be productive on the face of planet Earth. Anywhere they go, if they go abroad, I think Kerala is having one of the largest money order economy in this country, where a sizable population of Kerala are staying abroad, earning money, and Indians are supposed to be the best people in the world who will always earn wealth abroad, but always keep remitting money to the country. The second highest foreign exchange to India after your software exports, IT exports, is remittances. All the Indians staying abroad, not only Malayalis, all the Indians staying abroad have a pattern of sending remittances to India to build homes, to conduct marriages, to support siblings' education, siblings' houses, marriages. So it's a fantastic model. So government has a fantastic scheme in this vocation education.
Hi, I think just going back and looking in a different perspective, what is the skill training that you're giving the differently abled? It's 10% of the population. This is to all the panelists, especially to Mr. Angelo and Mr. Mohan. You've got excellent programs out there for people who are so-called gifted. But what are you doing for the differently abled? This is first question. 10%, huge, you can make them. And specific to NCDC, will you be taking up challenges or projects that the differently abled can present to you? So just two questions.
Government has got a lot of supporting schemes to the differently abled people. Lot of schemes where they are given scholarships to take skill-based education. One of the most successful skill-based education taken up by differently abled people is IT skills. IT skills where there are phenomenally successful people in the field of animation, multimedia, great programmers, and all this has been as an encouragement from the government. At the same time, I think every state has its own policy to support the differently abled people. What is disheartening is their initiative to take up these facilities. So there were a lot of bottlenecks, bureaucratic formats of working, which have now been eased out in the last 5 years. Otherwise, to get a scholarship for a differently abled person was not very easy. But in the last 5 years, government had removed a lot of hurdles, made it more easy for these people also to reach their right of taking a rightful skill-based education, government supporting them, and also getting helping them to get placed. Private organizations like us, we not only educate them, but we also try to fix them in the right pockets where employability will become easy and they can become there can be a source of revenue for them.
Just a follow-up before, ma'am, you answer that. Why not look at social inclusion as a part of policy? Social inclusion in education. Have at least two people who are differently abled in every classroom so that when they're out of government schools primarily, and when out of private schools, you have them integrated in society. There's no difference. You don't have to even call them differently abled, even if you have a vision for that.
That is already in place. But like I said, the initiative of the differently abled people is very low. So it becomes very difficult for a private player or the government to go on its own to look out. Government can do that. It is very difficult for the private players to go on look out for the differently abled people. But if they come up, then there is a lot of facilities that even private players forward for them to benefit socially. So that's in place.
I think that's covered by a lot of NGOs. NGOs play a role of linking between the private.
They do that. They do that very aggressively, very nicely, and that is very successfully being done. In fact, a lot of NGOs are today, nationally, I have interacted with a lot of NGOs who have also created their own vocational training facilities where they tie up with professional people like us for IT, with somebody else for air conditioning, with somebody else for plumbing, with somebody else for some other activity, bring the best services on board, and they conduct the training practices at their board itself, at their location itself. So that's also there in place.
Let me just finish this question. Yeah. One part of the question is left. All right. Thanks for asking that question. That's something that we did not mention, but NSDC has actually taken a project called PWD, which basically is for
for differently abled people. What we actually, we've done a pilot project, it actually including them in the normal way of actually and actually having them join. So we did that project, we actually realized that, you know, there's actually no standard of payment or standard of competency that's been required, right? We don't know that, for example, for this abled person, for this skill, how much should the person, what this competency, how much the person should be paid. So what we're doing right now, very, very interesting, like, just the way that we're making national occupational standards for different industries, we're also making occupational standards for differently abled people, which basically means if there's a person who has this a certain competency, this ability, and you know has this kind of you know age and salary and things like that, we are basically mapping that to that in that BPO industry, where does the person fit in, and actually what kind of salary has been done. So we actually have a lot of people across India who are, you know, who are NGOs and even in corporates, where actually intake differently abled people actually comes and sit together and actually do that mapping. And we actually were hoping to launch it maybe early next year and actually have this going for differently abled people. So I think that would be one of the things that we'd be very, very proud of doing.
Sector skill councils are there. Then these 26 councils prepare 26 types of curriculum or training modules. So I think it's a drawback.
No, they, for example, there's a retail sector, so there'll be one sector skill council for retail sector. And so there are 20. For example, we are the planning commission has come up with 22 high priority sectors, right? So based on that priority sector, we've come up with national occupation standards for each and every sector. The Ministry of Finance, it was launched, and 49% is owned by Ministry of Finance, 51% by the industrial associations like CII, ASSOCHAM, and things like that, yeah, and other organizations. But we are completely under the Ministry of Finance.
I have a question for you, Abbas. The thing is that NSTC has their own, sector skill councils, like 27 sector skill council. At the same time, in regard with NSDC, the students are getting certificate from the approved sector skill council after the training. The same time, AICT has formed another training modules, a National Occupational Education Qualification Framework. They have invited some SKPs and all. So through these SKPs, the students are getting certificate from the state universities or department, state education directorate and all. How can you integrate, the skill initiatives of the government in a single channel? Or instead of giving two certificates, one from NSDC, one from AICT. At the same time in Kerala, the government has formed another initiative, Additional Skill Acquisition Program, ASAP. So they are getting the certificate from KAC, Kerala State Academy for Skill and Excellence. So how can you integrate the three different skill modules or projects into a single system, being an apex body in the skill development in the country?
So that's a very good feedback. That's also something that we've also realized. That's why we're making the national framework. We're actually merging the two.
So the AICT approved SKP can walk with NSDC or?
Yeah, we're looking at how we're going to make an equivalent. It's work in progress. To be really honest, it's work in progress.
Thank you.
Yeah. The experience edupreneur after. Entrepreneur, it is an edupreneur. It is, I would like to sum up something like Vidya Danam, Param Danam. It is a tough process. All the statistics, all the help will come to you. But you have to ask yourself what you really want to be. What do you really want to do? It is at all the times you have to think that you are doing something good and you will get a lot of satisfaction out of it. At many times you will be very frustrated, you will have a lot of good statistics are there, all the departments will help you, but ultimately the hard work, innovation and what you call risk taking, and you have to have a lot of focus. That is, I would like to add.
I just want to also say that and as NSDC currently, we are actually doing this competition called Power to Empower, where we're not even looking for business plans. I mean, if you have a business plan, great, right? But if you have an idea which is based on skills, please come and submit your ideas. We are giving rewards and we're also giving mentorship for those ideas to actually become business plans. And if you have business plans, please submit those business plans. And for example, last year we had I already mentioned Just Rozgar, which actually came with a business plan, and now they are getting funded by NSDC. So log on to Power to Empower if you like, and start thinking about skills. I think it would be very, very interesting. It's an interesting place to be. Thank you so much.
There is this national innovation body which has got a fund of $1 billion, which is highly unutilized. So this innovation, because people are not approaching them, they are very generous in cooperating talent. So if you've got some good innovative ideas, I think you should go to it. Lot of education, democracy is happening in a lot of educational facilities. Like this gentleman was confused about whether you should take the certification from AICT or from NSDC and etc. etc. Very shortly, lot of universities will be clubbing together irrespective of the state, and this university is clubbing together because all universities don't have all programs. So if you're sitting in one state and if you want to do a university program in some other state, you can still be able to do that. That's going to be unfolding very shortly. The national government is investing big time in network of communication. So there are 1500 nodes which are being created by the government at the cost of $6 billion, out of which 450 nodes are already been created. 22,000 colleges are going to be connected through these nodes, through this network. Huge network is being set up throughout the country, and this network within the country is going to be connected with all the education platforms in Europe, in US, in all the developed countries of the world. So our research, our knowledge, our innovation, our information will be at par with the world. So there is going to be a lot of smooth flow of information. We need to be aware about it, and we need to be ready to encash this. A lot of people are not aware about it, but I think if you look at it, this is known as the national communication network, which we should all get into that bandwagon and start encashing those business opportunities also. Another space is creating automated training technology products. Automated training technology products can be used very, very widely for vocational education, because for plumbing, everything can be trained on videos. If I buy an iPhone, if I want to understand how to use an iPhone, I go to the YouTube. The YouTube is the best professor today. He is the best professor today. Whatever I want to learn, I can go to YouTube and understand how a device needs to be used, how a car needs to be driven, how I have to swim better. Everything can be there over there, but it's put in a very crude manner because individuals are uploading that content. As a business model, if entrepreneurs can get into that domain also, you can actually create some great video content, how to become a better plumber, how to become a better electrician, how to become a better network engineer. So this content building is also in great demand. Once the content is made, it can be dubbed in multiple languages. The content making is 100 rupees, for example. Content changing in different languages is a cost only to the tune of 25% to 30%. So if you also get into the content building domain, then a lot of vocational education entrepreneurs will buy that content from you, co-brand it with their brand, and then educate these students also. So 60% of the education can come from this format, and 40% of education can be given on-hands practice. Another aspect is a lot of industries are ready to give up their own working setups for entrepreneurs who can create vocational trainings on their setup, so that the people trained on their own setup can be absorbed by those companies as people who they need. So where your investment is also zero. You don't need the investments from organizations like National Skills Development Corporation also. These organizations are looking out for passionpreneurs. They are not looking out at entrepreneurs. They are looking out at passionpreneurs on whom they can trust faith that this gentleman can really run my setup in a way where he can educate people on vocations that we need, and we will absorb that manpower in the factories or the industries. Friends, let me tell you, in an overpopulated country like India, the challenge is not getting business. The challenge is getting the workforce who is skilled enough to execute that business which they have got. So educating the manpower is the country's largest challenge and the biggest opportunity for every Indian.
Yeah, I think what Mr. Rajesh was saying about the opportunities which exists in private sectors like Bosch, they are willing to take on entrepreneurs or passionpreneurs who can train the existing workforce and skill them in particular verticals. It could be in soft skills, it could be in behavior, leadership, anything. I think there are plenty of opportunities, and Vasudev Adigas in Bangalore, you know know them, they are growing gigantically. So they also need soft skills and behavior. So everybody wants some amount of training everywhere.
Thank you so much for your patience and time, and thanks everybody on the panelists. I think it was fun, and I'm hoping to interact with all of us, hoping to interact with you and actually take this forward. Thank you.
Thank you very much. But before concluding, please wait a minute. As a token of appreciation, may I request Mr. George Paul from Tycoon Kerala to hand over memento to our speakers and for our moderator. And firstly, for our moderator, Ms. Bint Abbas from National Skill Development Corporation. Thank you very much, ma'am. And now, sir, kindly hand over a memento to Mr. Mohan Rajamani, co-founder, LearnHive, and to Mr. Agnello Rajesh, CMD at Angelo Professional Association, and finally to Mr. Suresh Barwani, Chairman and Managing Director at JetKing. Thank you very much, sirs. Thank you very much. So with that, we are concluding this session, and thank you very much, people. And now here in track three, we have a pitch and a mentoring session by Mr. Manak Singh, co-creator, Sounding Board.